You just want to start playing, do you? Because I was just going to talk to you about what it is, how I see myself as your teacher. Because I'm not one of those teachers who says to my pupils, you must do it this way, or you must do it that way, or you must do it that way. I encourage you to be experimental throughout your entire life on the violin, to experiment trying things this way, that way. Now, for example, you've got the violin like that at the moment. What if you were to start playing it like a cello? Just and now try it. Do that with the whole bow, for example. See if you can get right to the end of the bow and see what happens to your hand. Yes, let's just play a little bit like that. Yes, great. Now, one reason I'm doing this is that there's a saying in English, we say, there are more ways to kill a cat than choking it with cream. Now, I've seen a video of an Arab violinist playing the violin that way, playing the Tchaikovsky violin concerto, which is one of them, the most difficult concertos to play. And he's just played it like that, exactly like that. Now, I think I told you the other day that in the drawings and etchings we have of the great violinist Paganini, we see him sometimes with his chin seems to be on this side of the violin, sometimes on that side of the violin, sometimes he's got the violin down here. And we talked a bit about that the other day, didn't we?
Yeah.
So I want to tell you something else about Paganini. I can just borrow your violin for a minute. It was a great, and the bow. It was a great revelation to me years ago when a friend of mine went to a famous teacher in London called Maxim Jacobson. Now, Maxim Jacobson was famous because he had found some of Paganini's own writings, and he learned this sort of thing. The sort of thing Paganini used to do was, I can't do it at my age really, but is to play the violin, because he was a bit of a showman on the thing. In other words, I'm trying to give you the idea that there isn't just one way to hold a violin. You hold it like that, you make a platform here, and you make it in there. There's not just one way. There are more ways of killing a cat than choking it with cream, as it were. So I just want to encourage, just have a go at that at the moment. You go in behind the car for one of your legs with a bar. That's right. Now, particularly as you're a busker, I'm remembering there was a string quartet of buskers some years ago in Melbourne, and they used to do all sorts of funny things like that. For example, one thing they would do would be to, if I could just turn your back to me if you would, they'd do something like this. Put the violin over there and you do the fingers and I'll do the bow. And they'd go round and round in a circle like that, you know, clowning. So I want you to think of the violin as a floating, very flexible thing that you can play with and enjoy experimenting and finding different ways of doing it. Not that we're going to spend all our time doing that work, but I want you also to tell me a bit about how you think I can help you, and what's, because you are your most important teacher, and it's very simple. You will spend much more time with yourself than I will. You'll only see me maybe as a teacher half an hour a week. But you, so what you discover for yourself is the most important thing. That's why I encourage experimenting. Okay. Now, did you have anything in particular you wanted to do today? Look at this, did you?
Yeah.
Okay, good. We'll put it up on the stand. I was very pleased to see the books that you already have, because a lot of the modern books I don't like at all, but these are excellent. Is it this piece you're going to play?
Yeah.
I better get my glasses so that I can read the music too.
I haven't played it.
Maybe Dad can adjust the stand.
I haven't played it for a while, but I wanted to learn this piece.
Don't worry. Thank you. Okay, and if you could just, well, you're taking films, aren't you? Can you read it all right from there?
Yeah.
I don't need to read it now, you just plug right in. Thank you. Yes. So what do you feel about that? How would you like to improve it?
Well, on these parts, it's kind of hard for me to, move a bow fast enough.
Oh, really? Right. Just bring the stand over to me a bit so I can see it a bit more clearly. See what the piece is. Oh, I see, right, yes, okay. The Saint-Quentin. I wonder why it's called that. Saint-Quentin means 50.
Well, maybe I just don't have enough rosin on my bow.
Oh, yes, well, you could. I noticed also you didn't tune up. Is that because your violin always stays in tune, or...? You don't have to bother.
I should tune it last night, that is it.
I tuned it last night, and also my violin normally doesn't go out of tune. Like, once I didn't play it for like 2 months on the summer holiday, and it still didn't go out of tune.
Well, I'll tell you my theory about tuning up. Because I remember I used to lead a number of different orchestras, and we always tuned. An oboe, if there was an oboe there, would give an A, and we'd all tune to that. Or if it was just strings, then the leader would play an A, and everybody would tune to that. And then one night, the leader of the orchestra brought along an electronic tuner, and he tuned all the instruments directly, individually, before we started the rehearsal. We never played so badly out of tune, as you can imagine.
Right.
It was a great surprise. Now, why? Why should we have played so badly out of tune when these have been electronically tuned?
Because violins have, like, different tones and stuff.
Yes, go on. The violin has different...
tones and sound, different ways it sounds, like some violins sound deeper than others.
Yes. Well, that's a very sensible answer. The answer I gave, which is part of the same story, is tuning up is about tuning up the player, not the instrument. And so when we tuned up together and we just listened to one A from the leader of the orchestra and we all played together, we were tuning up ourselves to be tuned into one another. And that was more important than the fact that we were tuning our instruments, because when the instruments were tuned in another room separately, and there's a funny story told about one of the great English conductors, Henry Wood, for example. Now, this story goes way back, but he became very particular about tuning the violins in his orchestra. So he would make them come into his office one by one and tune each their instruments. But apparently they used to trick him sometimes and send different players in with the same instrument all the time. So the story is that Henry Wood, he'd just tuned this instrument. The player would go outside and give the same instrument to the next player that's coming in for Henry Wood to tune it. And he would tune it. It's a bit like those stories they have. There's a psychological study. Someone's put in a room with a painting on the wall. And they just left there. They don't know quite why they're there. And they just look at the painting and they just think, oh, that's not quite straight. And so they straighten it up. And then the next person comes in and they look at the same painting and they do the same thing, but it's not quite straight and they're straight. So one after another, different people come in and they do doing it. So I suppose that Henry Wood was a little bit like that situation there, where he was seeing the same violin all the time, but retuning it. He didn't realise it was the one that he'd already just tuned. So that's the trick. So what I'd like us to do is actually tune together. Now, I'll get my violin.
There's one here.
That's lovely.
I think it needed rosin.
Now, that interestingly, you see, did you notice that that's a much different sound from the sound you were making when you were playing with the other piece? See, you were sitting down. We've just been chatting, you were sitting down and you just said, oh, play a bit of it. So you were very, very relaxed and the sound was lovely, open sound. And I encourage you to commit everything from memory as much as you can. I know you're doing that already, so, but well, I don't like the business of using a music stand. Can you think why I might not like that?
Because then you have to bring it around everywhere.
Because what?
Because you have to bring it around everywhere.
Oh, yes, that's another reason. Because you have to carry it with you. No, it's because it fixes. My approach to the violin is that it's a kind of dance we do. And we are actors. And sometimes we're very bold like this. And sometimes we're very intimate and friendly like this. That's why I think that Paganini, given that he used to do all these crazy exercises like bowing from behind his back, like this, that I think he probably had the violin, he probably moved from, because to judge by the paintings and drawings I've seen of him, he was not in a constant relationship to the violin. violin was sometimes over here, sometimes over here, sometimes down there. And to judge by Maxim Jacobson's teaching, sometimes he was playing with the violin here and the bow there. Yeah. I mean, he was a showman, an entertainer. He stormed the whole of Europe. It's said that he made more money, equivalent in his time, than the Beatles made in their time herein. That he was more famous than them in his impact. Now, he didn't get that by, if I can just take this for a moment, but he didn't achieve that by playing. He didn't excite people by doing that. Would you get excited doing that? I remember one lesson. I was getting so sick of Twinkle Twinkle Little Star teaching when I was teaching in a conservatorium for a while. I suddenly said, "Hey Melvin, what are you doing? Every week these students come in and they just, they play, and you wonder why they're not getting terribly excited. See if you can play." I suddenly said, "I'm going to start playing Twinkle Twinkle Little Star as though it is real music." And you know, there was a little girl, she was about 8 years old. The first day I did this, I came in, and by the time I had finished playing it to her, there were tears in her eyes running down her cheeks. And also almost in mine too, because I discovered that I can take even a little piece like that that everybody gets sick to death of, and they go, "Rattle, rattle, dump truck, rattle, rattle, dump truck, rattle, rattle, dump truck, rattle, rattle, dump truck," and they don't, you know, what? If I say twinkle, you think of a star, what a wonderful thing a star is, you know. "Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. Up above the world so high, like a potato in a beefsteak pie. Twink." Oh, that's the wrong word, isn't it? "Like a diamond in the sky." But you get what I'm saying? I'm talking about the difference between being a good student, following the books, and actually playing music, finding something in your soul. And so that's quite a challenge for you, with any of the pieces that you already know, to ask yourself now, what can I bring from inside myself to bring this to life in a really a way that's really going to engage the hearts and souls of people who come past you. So. Lovely. What's that song?
Love Story.
Love Story. Ah. I think that's a different song from the Love Story I know. Is that Henry Mancini's Love Story, do you know? All right, yes. So you were playing it with putting some feeling into it. Yes, yes. Well, I'm talking to you this way because I've heard you play and I know you've got a heart and soul connected with your violin. And the way I can help you is help you with your body, how to use your body to achieve the expression that you want to achieve. And now, one reason I got you to play like a cello to begin with, just play a little bit of something like a cello and then put the violin up and play it with the violin in your... Yes, now play it up with the shoulder. Well, that didn't show me what I was looking for, but that's good, because it was a much better sound on your shoulder. But I noticed that this hand was very relaxed. Now, I've got one of my grandsons I'm teaching, and he holds the violin so tight here that it tightens up his bow, and he sounds a bit like this. But if he plays like a cello, if he plays like that, he makes the most beautiful sound. So the question to my mind should be, why? And it's because if you have whatever tension you hold here, your hand was very relaxed then. So that's why you play the violin with making a beautiful sound. He's just a beginner, and so he makes these awful sounds. It's because he's grabbing this so tight, the tension there actually affects your bow arm. And it affects the way your bow approaches the string.
I used to hold the violin really hard, but my fingers started bleeding.
Sorry?
I used to press the violin super hard too, but then my fingers started bleeding.
Sorry, I'm not picking that up. But...
I used to press the violin strings hard too.
Yes.
But then my fingers started bleeding.
Oh, right. Yes. That's right, your fingers can get sore. Yes. So, what I'm wanting to alert you to is the way in which attention... So one reason, problem I have with chin rests, or with the way of using chin rests, is that if you use it just to grab the violin like that, then you're introducing a tension here, and it actually makes it very hard for the bow then to function in a really expressive way. Whereas if you're more relaxed, you can... See, that's already actually beginning to touch me. Did you notice the difference, Dad?
Nice.
It's fantastic. So that's, I always want to focus my attention on what is the goal? What do you want to achieve? You're obviously, you're out on the streets, you like playing for people, and you probably like making a little bit of money for yourself and or for debt or whatever and so on. So, how can you deepen that relationship with those people who come past? And you just showed me, because that's not normally how Twinkle Twinkle Little Star is played, is it? And when I say that you are your teacher, it's because you have to do this, you have to look inside your own soul and spend time with it, and that'll be your richness and pleasure in playing. To be looking for that, and then saying how can I use my body to achieve that. And I can tell you I'm 82 now, and I've been playing since I was 10 years old. I'm still discovering and learning things every day that I play. So, anyway, let's take a bit of the beginning of this piece again. You know a bit of it from memory, do you? You'll get away from the music altogether. Okay, now let's just wander around the room playing it.
Boom,
boom, boom. Now, imagine you're playing the violin and you're playing that piece and act it out. Dance this a piece. Make your own dance up, but... it might take a while to think about this sort of thing. It makes you a bit self-conscious, doesn't it? Well, look, you can just don't make up a dance and do this with me. Ba-dum, bum, bum, ba-da-ba-bum. Ba-dum, bum, bum, ba-da-ba-ba. Just stamp your foot at the beginning and halfway through each bar. Da-dum, stamp, dum, ba-da-ba-ba. Now, when you come, I want you to pretend you're playing the violin at the same time. So, ba-dum, bum, bum, ba-da-ba-ba. And just, we'll make a real long note there and express something, okay? Yes, but make a long note of that last one. Bah, so you're stretching your muscles. Ah, bum, 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 ba, ba, ba. Something like that. Have a go with the violin now. Let me say something else. When I give you ideas like this, I don't expect you to just copy me or be able to do it straight away. I'm just seeding you an idea of how you can involve your body expressively in playing in what you do up here. Another test. This time play it and look around the room as you're playing. You don't need to be looking at your fingers. And the reason I don't want you to be doing that particularly is because that fixes your neck. Looking at the fingers fixes the neck and it interferes with full expression of sound. So for this exercise, just let your head be free, and I can point to you. Look over to Deb, sway around, you're just playing the piece, and you're looking around the room, you're taking in objects, the jar up there, the funny little man there, anything like that. It's going to be more difficult for you than you imagine, because I don't want you to move the violin, I just want you to move your head. Yeah, look out the window there, without moving the violin. I want you to discover you don't need to be looking at your fingers to see if they're in the right place. Don't go too far, just work with a little bit that you're very familiar with, because we're just... And look over in that corner there. I'm going to hold your violin. You know, swing your head back and forth, looking at different things. Yes. See how the sound's changing? So, I believe that taking in the whole of your environment is a really vital part of playing really well, and particularly if you're busking, because part of it will be you'll be noticing different people come by and you'll be wanting in your heart to respond to them, to draw some musical connection out. And so, and you might follow them with your eyes like this. You might, of course, you don't have to have the violins fixed. I was holding the violin, but I just wanted you to loosen up your neck and find a way of holding the violin so that your neck is header free for your face to become really expressive and looking around as you play. What kind of world am I in? Oh, look. Something like that's probably enough for one day, do you think?
Yeah, no worries, we can take a break now and...
It's enough for a lifetime, really. And I'll tell you what, this, I mean, it might sound a bit crazy, but I'm nearer the end of my life than I've ever been, right? Okay. So when I have found someone like you, who's really keen and very, very gifted musically, and I want to give you, I try to give you ideas that will nourish you for the rest of your life, not just for you to find something, some answer right now, but that so in 10 years or 20 years time you say, oh, so that's what he meant. I can tell you this, recently one of my early teachers had a great thing about the thumb and so on. Just recently, in my own experimentation of that, I thought, oh, that's what he meant by that. That's about 60 years later, you know. So my approach to teaching is not to say, well, look, this week I want to improve that particular bar. I want to give you very general ideas that will nourish you for the rest of your life. Okay, thank you. Yes, one simple technical thing you can do is when you want to make a little bit of an emphasis, like over da-dum, bum, bum, if you want that bum, bum, just let the bow go a bit faster. You can experiment with that at home, different speeds of the bow to get different kinds of effect. Mm-hmm. Do you have something else you wanted to show me today? I'll sit down if that's all right.
You play whatever you like, Margaret.
Because I've only played a couple of songs in this book. Because I've actually been practicing book two.
And I'm sure you could have that one from memory by next week too.
Yeah, I could. Yeah.
So we can get away from the music stand. And please practice at home, experiment, just imagining you've got the violin and that you're dancing the music and see what you can discover that way. I'm sure that being half Chinese, you'll find different kinds of dances from those that I find. You'll find your own. That's lovely, yes. Now, let me just ask you something to think about, this business of whether you need to be looking at your fingers or not. I think it's one of the things that happens because in the early stages of violin, they're inclined to put marks on the fingerboard, tapes across the fingerboard to show where the marks are. And so you're encouraged to look to see that you're putting your fingers on the right place. Now let me ask, you sing, don't you? You sing?
Sometimes.
Yes, you can sing. I've heard you sing, and you sing very nicely. You sing in tune, don't you? You find the notes. Do you have to look inside your larynx there and see whether you're using it in the right way to sing? Yeah. No, you don't. Biologically, and you also, don't need to be looking at your fingers.
And also, since I play the piano, I can kind of use my ears to tell if I'm playing the notes right or not.
Yes, that's right. Our fingers, the same with our voice, they will find the notes using, that's what I say, you're your teacher. And that's those moments where you discover notes and discover things yourself and look around and discover this difference. I've seen workshops years ago where Vivian Mackey, this was an Alexander teacher, but she would do the, what I was just doing with you then, get the, someone playing the violin rather stiffly and a little bit just sort of, and very nicely, I don't want to be critical of it, but very nicely, no, I can't do it stiffly, but, and she would just get them to start looking around the room, and you would not believe the change that took place when they actually achieved that, freed up their necks so that they could actually engage with the environment they were in. Fantastic.
Made a difference, yeah. How do you like that, Margaret?